is also supplemented then with a much more recent rail link which goes from Folkestone then up to London, the high speed rail link which enables trains to pass through, and you can in fact get a train then from London through to Paris all the way on the high speed line, and it's a line which is really very quick. It takes you about 3 hours for the whole thing, which is much quicker in fact than flying when you take into account the check-in times and such like. It's a quicker way indeed, so that's proved very popular then over the years. Also some people even use that to commute, so people in nearby Ashford and Canterbury, they will commute up using the Channel Tunnel. They can get from Canterbury then into London in less than an hour, so it's still very doable. Kent here, it's the it's a county in England. England is divided into counties, and they're much larger than the counties that you'd know in the States. The county is almost more the equivalent of a state or a province, really. It's, it stretches from the southeast of England all the way up to the London borders, Kent does. So it's really very much the each of them has their main town, the major city, and that's known as the county town, and Canterbury is the county town then for Kent. Kent then in the southeast, it has a very long history. Its motto is Invicta, because the Kentish like to say that they were not conquered by William the Conqueror when he came in 1066 and conquered England, and he essentially built lots of castles and such like, and really wanted to establish himself as the boss, which essentially he did. He was then him and his court became the dominant court, and his descendants ruled for centuries then afterwards, his and some of the other French kings and royal families. The French the language of the court in England was French, in fact, for many years. And one of the things he did then, William the Conqueror, when he invaded, he came to Kent and he was on his way up to London. The Kentish people then said that they would not surrender to him, and for whatever reason, perhaps because his soldiers were already battle-weary from fighting the Battle of Hastings, he decided to give in to their demands, basically, and say, I will meet you halfway and allow you certain rights and liberties which otherwise he wouldn't have done. And there is evidence to this day that that was the case. For example, the old Anglo-Saxon tradition of cavalkin, the form of inheritance where the money is split equally between the sons, that was retained in Kent for until the early 20th century, in fact, unlike the rest of the country where it was switched over to the Norman system where it goes to the eldest son. So there are some differences in Kent which were retained for a long time. We sort of lay evidence then to the claim that the Kent was unconquered, but they certainly like to call themselves Invicta as a result. But it's true nevertheless that lots of castles and cathedrals were built during the time of William the Conqueror, as he wanted to stamp his authority on the country. So in Canterbury there was the cathedral built there in stone, and likewise the castle there. And Leeds Castle is again another of these, because William the Conqueror, he came and he set up essentially a power structure, his court and his lords and his barons were the people who would enforce his law on a day-to-day basis. And this was the castle was given to the Crevecourt family. Leeds Castle, it actually dates back to the 9th century, and in fact King Ethelbert IV granted the manor of Leeds to his chief minister, who was called Led, and that's possibly the name of the castle, or the name of the village where it's based, was called Led, and that developed then into Leeds. Not to be mistaken for Leeds in the north of England, which is a large industrial city. Lots of people think that Leeds Castle will be up near that place, but it's not. It's in the south of England. but that castle was then replaced by the one built by the Crevecourt family, and then this one built in stone, and so we replaced the old wooden building, and it's a building then which the parts still exist today. The old wine cellar still exists in the current building, so that's lasted pretty well throughout the years. And the building then was built upon later. Edward I, who is also known as Harold the Scots, you may know him from the Braveheart movies. He's the king who suppressed much of Scotland. William Wallace fought against him for Scottish independence. He stayed at the castle and stayed with his wife, Eleanor of Castile. Eleanor of Castile fell in love with the castle, and so he decided to buy the castle for her and started a tradition, in fact, of the castle being bought for the Queen and being the residence of the Queen, and in many cases then the Queen then staying in residence in the castle once their husband had died and another king had taken the throne. And Eleanor of Castile brought a very Spanish look to it. She was influenced, of course, she was from Spain, and Spain was influenced by the Moorish architecture at the time, and she built the gloriette and the upper courtyard in the castle that again we can still see today, up next to the Barbican, the fortress area. And she also made it very luxurious for the time, lots of carpet, which was unusual at the time, and she kitted it out in very interesting sort of unusual manner for the time in England. Later on then it passed through several other kings and queens. Perhaps the most famous of those is Henry VIII. Henry VIII, the big king, who's known perhaps most of all for having six wives. His first wife was Catherine of Aragon, and then he later had his various marriages then annulled. But his first one with Catherine of Aragon was a very long marriage, and he stayed there with Catherine of Aragon on his way to meet King Francis at the Field of the Cloth of Gold in 1520. And it was at this time then that he gave the castle to his wife Catherine of Aragon, and there we can see still many features such as the pomegranate, the logo of the family of the Spanish royal family at the time. And he created the banqueting hall there with the ebony floor. Then it passed through many different members of the aristocracy until it then became too expensive then for the upkeep for many of them. This is a common theme actually. Many of the stately homes that previously been owned by the aristocracy and lived in by the aristocracy, they became very expensive in terms of the staffing costs and maintenance. And what happened is much of those had to be sold off, and some of them they opened up part of it perhaps to be used as a hotel or in fact for filming purposes. If you're familiar with Downton Abbey, the TV series, that's filmed at Highclere, and that's one where the family decided to rent it out for filming purposes, and then that took on its own momentum in that case and became a very lucrative sideline for the companies, for the families. So that happened in a great deal of these cases. And likewise then the Wickham Martin family were the last owners of the castle, and they had to sell it on. They had to then find somebody who was rich and willing to take that on. And what was very common at the time was for members of the British aristocracy to marry American socialites. Winston Churchill's mother did that. She was, Winston Churchill's father did that rather. He was half American, and his mother was a Consuelo Vanderbilt, and they then found the money to look after Blenheim Palace. And that's exactly what happened then here in Leeds Castle. It was the lady who became known as Lady Bailey. Originally she was Olive Paget, and she was the lady who inherited a large amount of money then from her family. She then married Adrian Bailey, who was a local member of Parliament for Tunbridge, and as a result, she became a lady baby. She became a member of the aristocracy, a member of the aristocracy with much means and the ability to look after the castle as it should be looked after. And that's exactly what she did. She lived there and moved in then in the 20s. It was 1926 when she moved in there, and she decorated it then very much in the style of the Roaring Twenties, and lots of different artworks from that era, lots of different models of birds and cats, because she was a big lover of those animals in particular. And so the current castle, as it would be seen now, it's really an ancient castle with a 1920s revamp done to it. So it's a very interesting style indeed for that. And as I say, much work done in the 20s to change such of the heating and such like to make that modern for the time and hidden. And many new materials are in use, and for much of the decor, such as a plastic, which was new, expensive and exotic at the time. And there are some items in the bathroom there which are made in fact of plastic, but then set with semi-precious stone, because plastic at the time was an exotic material, just like the semi-precious stones. So it's a very interesting mix of all of those, and a castle which many people have fallen in love with, because it's the traditional chocolate box kind of style of castle surrounded by the moat there. It looks very impressive in the ground, and there are impressive trees and gardens around. You can also in the free time have a walk around the garden and have a look at the wildlife that's there being cultivated. And there's also, because Lady Bailey was a big fan of dogs, there's also a dog collar museum, so if you're a fan of dog collars, then by all means you can check out the dog collar museum. So all of that awaits us then in Leeds Castle, the idyllic castle in the south of England. And we're about half of the way there now, so I will let you enjoy the rest of the route there through the Kent countryside, and we will be there at about 9:30, maybe a bit before, and let you sit back and enjoy the rest of the ride.
also can't break the sight. None of the cars should be that side of the barrier.
Yes.
Yeah, it's all prepped, ready for this weekend.